Please stand for the reading of God's word. The following scripture was given that we might fulfill our mission to help others to trust and follow Jesus. Our text is from 1 Peter chapter 5. To the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder and a witness of Christ's sufferings, who also will share in the glory to be revealed. Be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, watching over them, not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be. Not pursuing dishonest gain, but eager to serve. Not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. In the same way, you who are younger, submit yourselves to your elders. All of you, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another, because God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. This is the word of God for the people of God. You may be seated.
Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for the gracious blessing of knowing you, hearing your voice, and feeling drawn by your spirit to go deeper in our faith. We praise you as the one true God, creator of heaven and earth, giver of every good and perfect gift. We celebrate your holiness and perfection. We're wonderstruck by your power. And every single one of us, no matter where we come from, how much money we have, how old we are, what our education level may be, spiritual background, we all just admit that we desperately need you. Would you help us navigate the circumstances of our lives? Would you bring clarity to the questions and mysteries we're pondering? And where there is shame, bring freedom. And where there is despair, bring hope. We look to you and you alone for these things. King Jesus, our risen Messiah, you are the most brilliant teacher who ever lived. Come teach us now. We pray in your name, Jesus. Amen. If you haven't already, go ahead and turn to 1 Peter chapter 5. It will be helpful to keep your Bible open through the duration of this message. We're going to be in 1 Peter 5, but we'll also look at chapter 4. So just keep it open, and it'll help you and serve you if you can see the actual text in front of you through this sermon. And if you have a phone or a device, in many ways that's even better, especially in a sermon like this. I'll make reference to another version, and you'll be able to click on it and see it and not just take my word for it. So before we get into the world of 1 Peter 5, I want to celebrate something that happened last week that really encouraged me. We had a men's movie night here in this room. Mike Neal and Doug Robertson and Jason Henderson smoked some super delicious meat. Of course, I would go to food first. It was so good. We thought the meat would last like for a couple of trips, but over 95 guys were here, which you never know when you plan these things in July on a Saturday night, how many people are going to come. We were really encouraged by the turnout, And then we watched this movie that hardly anybody had heard of. It was called The Heart of Man. It's on Netflix right now, and we usually don't use the pulpit of the church to recommend movies, but you have to see this movie. Seriously, if I could make you watch this movie, I would totally do it. Go out and watch this movie. It's on Netflix, The Heart of Man. If you're a woman and you're like, it's not The Heart of Woman, I'm not going to watch it. It could equally be called The Heart of Humanity. So we'll just say that. Go watch the movie. It is surprisingly deep, and it had this arresting effect on me and so many other guys. The conversations that have come after it have been refreshing and transparent, and stuff that we usually don't talk about was put on the table. And I just give praise, not just for the film itself, but for the interactions that I've been able to have personally. And I've heard rumblings of other things that have happened throughout the church after viewing the movie. But I'm grateful that we have a gospel culture that's not perfect and messy, but at Harpeth Christian Church, I'm so grateful that I can confidently say that we can share our real lives, the good, the bad, and the ugly. We can be fully known and fully loved and yet challenged to take our next step with Jesus, whatever that next step may be. I'm grateful that God has granted us a culture like that at Harpeth. And if you're looking for a church home, I'll spare you the sales pitch for the church. I just hope you'll seriously consider this body of believers, and you'll hear more about our core beliefs and how we're led, even in this sermon as we unfold 1 Peter 5. So, this is part 15 of a series called Living Hope. We've opened 1 Peter, and we've been going verse by verse, and we started it on Easter Sunday. Believe it or not, it's been quite a journey. It's been quite a lengthy journey. We begin something new in August. It will be very exciting. Harpeth Christian Church will be an inspiring and hopeful and exciting place during the month of August, and that's all I want to say about it right now, but you don't want to miss a single week at Harpeth. I can promise you that, especially in August. We chose 1 Peter because it gives clear answers to a complex question. How should followers of Jesus live in this cultural moment? With everything that's going on in the world right now, the nonstop drama in politics, the ever-changing spiritual landscape of this country, one crisis after the other, it seems, all over the world, and then in our cities, our neighborhoods, our schools, our families, there's so much chaos all around us, and there seems to be no end in sight. What does trusting and following Jesus look like in the real world where we live? Peter tackles this question in a very different time and era in world history, but the challenges and the adversities they faced back then are strikingly similar to the ones we face today. In chapter 1, he introduces us to a truly revolutionary idea called living hope. Chapter 1, verse 3. Maybe the most inspiring verse in the whole Bible. You have been born again into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. It's kept in heaven for you. It's unfading, indestructible, untouchable, and it's for you. You can rest in this crazy world in these never-changing realities. You have been given living hope. He's writing to a community of churches in the first century who are under the oppression of the Roman Empire. They feel threatened, afraid, and anxious. They face violence and rejection and their own death all day, every day. Peter says, take heart. Peter, who was personally discipled by Jesus himself, says, take heart. Remember Jesus. Consider him. Remember what he accomplished for you when he died and rose again, and that he is always with us. And remember who you are. Don't let the world hijack your identity. Don't let the enemy lie to you and whisper deceptions in your ear about who you are. Let God, your creator, define you. You've been given living hope. You are a priest. You are a son, a daughter of God, born again, filled with the Spirit, recipient of the treasures of heaven. See this and embrace it and live with it. Be who you are. Don't be some false or phony, shallow, cheap version of you. Don't try to wear somebody else's skin. Be who you are. Be who God has created you to be. When we place our confidence in the risen Lord Jesus day by day, moment by moment, breath by breath, prayer by prayer, God gives us living hope. And when we try to get some other form of hope, we can call it dying hope, we have no hope at all. There is no hope apart from the empty tomb of Jesus. A few years ago, it dawned on me, and perhaps this has happened to you as well, that the quality of my life, the direction of my life, the essence of my life, would be determined by how I answer a singular question. Is Jesus dead or is he alive? Is he dead or alive? Pick one. Can't be both. There's lots of mysteries in the universe, lots of room for gray, black or white thinking, I think has been revealed as mainly unhealthy in most situations. But in this one, there's a clear line in the sand. Is Jesus dead or is he alive? If he's dead, he's a fake, he's a liar, he's a fraud. He's not a good man, he's not a good teacher. He is a living lie. If he's dead, this story isn't true. He's not a leader worth following in any regard. If he's dead, then Christianity is a destructive hoax, maybe the most elaborately destructive hoax the world has ever known. If he's dead, our faith is totally pointless. If he's dead, then we can throw this Bible away in the trash can. If he's dead, if he's not been raised from the dead, as 1 Corinthians 15 plainly says, then you and me, we're all dead in our sins. We are responsible for paying the price for our sins. Can you think of anything more harrowing than that? If he's dead, then every church in the world should shut down and cease to exist. If the resurrection did not happen, then we should be pitied more than anyone on the earth. We're misguided fools. We've based our whole life on a lie. If he's dead, then any notion of hope beyond the grave is just pixie dust. It's a fantasy. But on the other hand, if he's alive, as the Bible says over and over and over again, if he's alive, then you can't call Jesus just another good man or good moral teacher. He's a bit more than that. If he's alive, he cannot and must not be included on the buffet line of world religions. If he's alive, he has the power to bring dead things to life. Dead faith, dead marriages, dead dreams, dead anything. Jesus can bring it back. If he's alive, then his movement is unstoppable in his people, namely us. We should be fearless. If he's alive, then he demands our ultimate, passionate, heartfelt allegiance. If he's alive, we should stop whatever we're doing, fall to our knees, acknowledge his awesomeness and supremacy, and rearrange our entire lives according to his will. Peter weaves this theme of hope, of living hope, through chapters 1 and 2. And it's a rainforest of good news. And then in chapter 3, he starts to talk about something hard. Suffering. You're going to suffer, he says. Don't be shocked or surprised as though something strange were happening. Let God transform you and refine you in the midst of it. Don't walk away from God, the one who can redeem your pain. Don't collapse underneath the heavy load of the trial. Let the fire refine you and bring out the best in you. Peter says that suffering, well, reveals the goodness and glory of God like nothing else can. In chapter 5, he takes yet another unexpected turn. Nobody saw this coming. And I've read 1 Peter I don't know how many times, But even this week, I was reading verse 1, and I was like, this seems like an abrupt tangent. Why is he addressing elders, to the elders among you? Actually, and this is where having that Bible app on your device is going to be helpful. In the New International Version, there's a word omitted that you'll find in the New American Standard. In the NASB, the first word of verse 1 is therefore. Now, that's a really important word because it, in essence, means in view of everything I've said, I'm going to talk to the elders now. Well, no wonder it seemed like some rabbit Peter was chasing. I was reading the wrong version. I love the NIV. But there's a word missing. It's therefore. There is a reason. There is purpose. He's being intentional. Why is he talking to the elders at this point, at the very end of the letter? That word therefore, that was omitted by the translation committee of the NIV, gives us a clue. But before I go there, I need to say something that probably doesn't even need to be said, but I'm going to say it. This text assumes that the church is led by a group of elders. This is the first century. These are the original disciples of Jesus, if you want to call them that. And there is absolutely no evidence that any church anywhere in that day was led by a single person. It was a plurality of God-ordained, spiritually mature, proven over time men who collectively shepherded the flock of God. That's the way it was in every church. And they weren't leading a company driven by bottom lines and budgets and competition with the other shops in town. They were shepherding the church. They're discerning the will of God together in community because they knew that God told us is more powerful than God told me. Haven't we seen overwhelming reasons why the pastor, king, one-man show church model really doesn't work? It's not healthy. It's not biblical. And this is not to throw stones or to say, well, we've got it right at Harpeth. If you've been around here long enough, you know that we don't have it all together here. But Scripture couldn't be any clearer. The church that Jesus bought with his blood is led by a group of elders. The church is not a corporation. We do not play by the rules of this world. It's a different kingdom, different king, very different definitions of success and beauty and goodness. Humility and submission, love, truth, sacrifice, those are the hallmarks of the church that Jesus leads. I know it's church shopping season for many people. It's July, school's in session soon. A lot of people move into the area looking for a church. There is a growing group of people that go from church to church, and they're trying to figure out what church is going to be the best fit for them. Even the phrase church shopping, it should give us some irritation because the mindset of a consumer, it's our default setting. Our culture has trained us to think that way. And it can keep us spiritually immature for a long time if we're always consuming things. But if you're looking for a church and you're thinking about where you or your family unit might flourish, I would encourage you to look first at how whatever church you're looking at is led. Who are they? It needs to be a they first, not a him or a her. It needs to be a they. Do they meet the biblical qualifications? And if the answer is no, I would never go back. I feel like that sounds angry and old-fashioned, but I'm pretty sure it's just biblical. Thank you. I needed that. The people pleaser in me was screaming until you said amen. Okay, back to the question. Why address the elders now? Why does Peter talk to the elders? So Peter has been warning the church, and for the next few minutes, you're going to be tempted to dial out because, okay, he's getting into too much history. He's getting into the Old Testament. Stay with me. There's a payoff toward the end of this that you won't get unless you stay with me. So every now and then, nod at me, wave something at me, or just give me some indication that you're with me, because it's important that we stay together through this. Peter has been warning the church about a fiery ordeal. It could have been that it was a literal fire. Like the Emperor Nero was burning Christians alive and lighting up his gardens with the dead bodies of Christians. He could have been talking about that fiery ordeal. It could have been more general. Just the church is being tested, severely tested and persecuted back in those days, and it still is all over the world, by the way. But he says in chapter 4, verse 12, that there's been a fiery ordeal that has come to test you. He says in verse 13 of chapter 4 that followers of Jesus may share in the sufferings of Christ for a season and then exalt in the glory of Christ when he comes. It gets clearer in chapter 4, verse 17. He explains why the fiery trial is coming on the church. He says in verse 17, "For it is time for judgment to begin with the household of God. And if it begins with us first, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God?" So what that means, and this is for the whole church, not for the elders, the fiery ordeal that comes as a punishment, as a condemnation on unbelievers, it hits the church first as a fire of purification and refining. And there are two background texts in the Old Testament that you need to be aware of. We're not going to go deep into this, but I would love for you to write this down and just explore these passages. The first one is Ezekiel chapter 9. This is one of those passages in the Old Testament that you read and you're like, whoa, what? The wrath of God is on full display in this text. And it comes first to his own people, and then it moves out to the surrounding culture. But there's a principle here. If Peter has in mind the way God once began his judgment in his own house, he may be saying, hey, it's getting really hard, I know, in Rome and in the provinces and the cities, but it's going to start here in the church, and it always starts in the church with the elders, the people who lead. So maybe he's trying to exhort and encourage those elders to press on because they're undergoing severe, severe testing. The second background text is Malachi chapter 3, where God says that his messenger is going to come to his temple. Just the way Peter says in chapter 2, verse 5 of 1 Peter. But I want to read to you Malachi 3, just a little excerpt here. This is talking about an encounter that God will have with his own people. This is not for the world, this is with his own people. Who can endure the day of his coming? Who can stand when the Lord appears? For he will be like a refiner's fire. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. He will purify the Levites, that's crucial, and refine them like gold and silver. The Levites are the priests, the equivalent in the Old Testament of our elders. Now, it's true that in 1 Peter 2, all believers are priests. But it's not easy for a leader to read this and fail to see that the refining fire of God's judgment comes to the leadership first. The fire purifies the leaders first. That's the way it goes in the kingdom. So when Peter says in chapter 4, verse 17, it's time for judgment to begin with the household of God, it's easy to see why in chapter 5, verse 1, the New American Standard would say, therefore. Therefore, in view of the fact that God's judgment is coming, and it's coming to the church, and when God visits the church, he always starts with the elders. In view of that, I have something to say to the elders. That's what Peter's saying. It's a wonderful and sobering thing to be an elder in the church that Jesus purchased with his own blood. Here's something worth noting. If the elders lead the church into strength and vitality and fruitfulness and unity, as they're charged to do, they will also lead the church into the refiner's fire of God's purifying judgment. They will not stand above the church or outside the church in a boardroom at a conference table with a whiteboard giving us suggestions on how we should cope with the fires of life. They will lead the church into the fire. They will go first. They will feel the heat first, and it will be hottest for them. So when Peter says in verse 1, I'm a fellow elder, he's not saying, I have a special title. He could have called himself an apostle. That's the truth. He's saying, I'm with you, elders. I know it's hard. I know the fires are raging, but I am with you. I stand with you in that place of desperation. I've seen and experienced the suffering of Jesus in my own life. I stand with you in utter dependency on God as the trials of life turn up their heat and test us all. Peter is trying to pump some hope into those elders. Peter believes that those elders need a special message at the end of his letter. Fire is painful. Judgment is serious. And the stakes for the church are so high. It's coming on the house of God. That's what the text says. And the elders first. In this situation, the elders need wisdom and encouragement. And so Peter gives them plenty of both. Three words of wisdom for elders. If you're aspiring to be an elder one day, or if you're in a church, you're in this church, and you're in a community led by elders, I would love for you to sort of perk up and listen to this. Also, this is not just for elders. This applies to home group leaders. It applies to anybody who seeks to make disciples of Jesus. If you have any influence in this church at all, it does apply to everyday Christians. It's especially for elders, but there's something for all of us in these three words of wisdom. We're going to go fast. They're right here in the text. Word number one, pearls of wisdom. Pearl one, go all in. Don't shrink back. Elders, don't. Go all in. Be shepherds of God's flock, verse 2, that is under your care, watching over them, not because you must, but because you're willing. Peter warns the elders against drifting into a heartless or distracted or detached pattern of ministry that requires some sort of external motivation or compulsion to lead. So don't be afraid of doing what you're called to do. Just go and do it. It may not be apathy that they're dealing with. It may be fear. They may be legitimately afraid. Who wouldn't be in those situations, the first century? This is why we would never pressure anybody at Harpeth Christian Church to be an elder. We would never surround a guy and say, you have to be an elder. You're duty-bound to be an elder. That's not the way it works. A man's got to feel called and confirmed, and then once he becomes an elder, he should shepherd the flock willingly and from the heart. I want to say a word about our elders here. I'm feeling kind of sentimental and reflective right now, so if this feels a little sappy, you've been warned. We celebrated two anniversaries this month. Yesterday was my 17th anniversary with Joni in our marriage. And we're, yeah, celebrate that. I am. Apart from Jesus, Joni's the clearest expression of God's grace and beauty in my life, hands down. The other anniversary is our 5-year anniversary of coming to Harpeth. It's been 5 years since we joined the work here. So much has happened. So much. I could tell lots of stories. Many of them would bring tears. But when I think about our elders, Mike Shake, Gary Tanner, Ed Kaiser, David Sanders, Bobby Harrington, Tony Dupree, and Mike Eagle, I can't remember a single time in my life as a disciple of Jesus or as a preacher of the gospel when I have been more encouraged and more grateful for a group of elders than I am right now. After 5 years in a relationship, the makeup is off. You know, you see people as they are. You go behind the curtain and you see the process for how the sausage gets made. Many a pastor has become cynical and burned out after going behind that curtain. A lot of dropout. A lot of cynicism. But the longer I live, work, and serve here, the more hopeful and optimistic I am about church. Not only just in general, but this church and these elders. I'm so grateful to be able to say that. So grateful. There are no power mongers in our elder group. There are no rogue elders. There are no perfect elders. They are unified. They serve us with full hearts. They're the healthiest and most God-honoring elder group I've ever seen. They are not a board of directors thinking mainly about policies and procedures and institutional advancement. That's not their speed. That's not their deal. They're not shopkeepers, always looking to the right or the left. How can we one-up that church or get bigger than that church? How can we steal some people from that church? That's more honest, right? And get them here. The last thing our elders are thinking about, I can promise you, is there's not enough people here. They're a community of shepherds who call us to be disciples of Jesus, who make disciples of Jesus. They serve, they pray. At the movie night last week, I was leaving, and I was worn out from vacation and just life, and I was like, I want to go home and go to bed. And I looked over, and David Sanders was sweeping the floor. Like, you know, there's the elder. Anybody who thinks that the elder role is a glamorous position needs to see David, who's been there here from day one, sweeping the floor. Or if something goes haywire in my life, all I've got to do is throw up a flare to any number of these elders, and I know that they would be there. They pray, they walk with us. I'm so grateful. Word number two. Check your motives. Peter warns the elders against greed, the lust for money and power, prestige. Verse 2 says, shepherd the flock, not pursuing dishonest gain, but eager to serve. In other words, don't lead for the wrong reasons. Have you ever seen a bad elder before? I have. I got some stories. I will not share them here. Elders who want power and influence, and they enter into the elder group for less than honorable reasons. I've seen it. I've been hurt by it. I've seen churches destroyed by it. Peter says that rather than be a prideful elder or leader, do your ministry with eagerness. Lean in. Love your work. Find joy in serving the church of Jesus Christ. Hebrews 13 says, let the elders minister with joy and not grief. This would be unprofitable for you. Word number three. This is the third pearl of wisdom from Peter for elders. Lead with humility. Verse 3 says, shepherd the flock, not lording it over those entrusted to you. Notice that phrase, entrusted to you. I immediately thought of my children who are entrusted to Joni and me for a season and then they depart. But they are ultimately not mine. I don't own them. They belong to God. That's the way Peter talks about churches. Like, hey, elders, don't be thinking this is all you. These are not your people. They're entrusted to you. Treat them accordingly. Be shepherds. Be examples for them. He's warning the elders to reject pride. Pride is the failure to realize how deeply desperate we all are for Jesus. It's not understanding that without Jesus we can do nothing. And so the proud heart starts to feel that it can be self-reliant. And self-reliance can become this blinding arrogance that says, it's all about me. I'm indispensable. This work can't carry on. I am unreplaceable. They have to have me. Have y'all heard any church scandal stories lately? Have you heard about any moral failures out there in the church? It's almost a cliche now, folks. They're dropping like flies all over the country. And it's not first and foremost about lust or money or lying or dishonesty. It's about pride. It all goes back to believing the lie that we don't need God. And Peter says to the elders, do not exalt yourselves like that. Lead like Jesus with humility. And when that fiery ordeal comes to you first, lead by example. Don't bail on the process. Don't escape it. Don't run from it. Walk through it with the sheep. That's the way Peter encourages elders. We should listen closely to it, church. And then he ends with a word of hope. Of course he would. Peter saw Jesus rise from the dead. How could he not brim over with hope in every verse? In verse 4 it says, when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. There may be times when the elders feel that the refining fire is too hot. We may feel that if it takes this much fire to burn away our sin and laziness and greed and pride, idolatry, then maybe it's not worth it. If it takes this much pain, maybe I should quit. And to those who feel tempted to walk away, Peter says, there will be a day when the chief shepherd, the lead elder, will appear. And it will be so satisfying and spectacular that all of the service and the tears and the prayers and the late nights, the agony, and all the work will be worth it. There will be a day for all of us when we stand before Him. It'll be really, really good. But I think there will be a private conversation, a personalized word of blessing from Jesus who launched the church and elders who lead the church. Some of those conversations are going to be very painful. We may or may not get to see them. I don't know. But many of them will be beautiful. He ends the passage with a brief word to those who are younger. I'll let you decide if you fit that description. A word to the younger, verse 5. Submit yourselves to your elders. That's what it says. I would encourage all of us, I put myself in this boat right there with you, to ask ourselves, what do our elders call us to do as a church? If you're a member, you have a membership covenant, you have literature from our Check Us Out seminar. If it's been a while since you read that, I would encourage you to brush up on it. Just look at it. And remember, as I frequently say, this is not like joining Costco. It's a little different than that. That we're in this together. We're on mission together. We need each other. And we are attempting to embark on a mission and a journey together that requires supernatural help. It's a big deal. We should give our elders the respect, the honor, and the trust that they're due. The key principle for this whole passage is verse 5 to the end. All of you, elders, young people, everybody, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another. Because God opposes the proud but shows favor to the humble. Clothe yourselves with humility, Peter says, like a garment, like a shirt. Put it on. You all know what humility is. I don't need to get up here and define it. You know it when you see it. You're drawn to it. It's attractive. It's refreshing. Who doesn't want to be around a humble, life-giving person? But you also can feel it, and you're repulsed by the opposite, the arrogance and the pride of someone who has a high estimation of himself. It's like, ooh, I don't want to be around you anymore. I'm going to exit stage right here and find somewhere else to go. Everybody loves humility, and we're drawn to humble people, but in my experience, hardly anybody wants to put the necessary work in to cultivate humility. We're not born humble. Humility is not the default setting of the human heart. Selfishness is. And the only way to break free from that default setting is to partner with the Holy Spirit in the cultivation of humility over a long time. And God brings us humility in two ways, through disciplines, spiritual disciplines, and suffering. We are broken by the trials of life and by spiritual disciplines that disciples of Jesus have been practicing for hundreds of years. We are no exception. So if you want to be a humble person, this is going to be really fast, rapid fire. You'll need to do 6 things. You ready for this? You thought I was done. It's a cruel joke, I know. Number 1, you'll have to live in the presence of God. Practice the presence of God. Don't forget about God. Live moment by moment in the presence of God, because it's impossible to be prideful and aware of God's presence at the same time, because there's only one God, right? Number 2, confess sin. Not sin in general, not in your prayer closet, to another person. Not because that's the only way you can get forgiven, or because you're under obligation to do so, but because you want to be free from the prison of sin, and you want to cultivate the fruit of humility, and saying, I did that, it was wrong. I need help, and I need to repent. Verbalizing those truths has a way of pouring humility into our hearts. Number 3, connecting deeply in transparent relationships with other disciples. Not flying solo as a spiritual Christian who just doesn't really have time to befriend others and walk in the light. Connecting deeply in transparent relationships. Number 4, serving other people who can't repay you. Asking God to open doors for you to really serve Not for what you can get, but for what you can give. Number five, watch this one. Befriending people who will not enhance your status. Every disciple of Jesus should have a few friends that if somebody from the outside saw the friendship, they'd be like, that's not right. How does that work? So she's friends with her. Like, I don't get that. Or he's at lunch with him. Like, it's a mystery. We all should have some friends like that. Friendship in our day is transactional. It's selfish. It's shallow. The church should completely reject that way of thinking. And we should have open, hospitable hearts. And we should befriend people who cannot help us move up. Jesus descended and befriended us. And that's remarkable because his descent into my world is way more extreme than any descent I can make into your world, believe me. Number six, abiding in Christ. Simply abiding in Christ, connecting with Jesus. If you haven't read John 15 in a while, would encourage you to go drink deeply those words. And that's all I'll say about that. So what's your plan to grow in humility? You got a game plan? If you don't have a plan, there won't be fruit. I would encourage you, if you plan on being a life-giving person that loves well, that's faithful to what the Bible calls you to do, if you're married, if you're a human being, make humility a top priority in your life and go for it. Do anything and everything you can to cultivate it as a fruit. It will pay you back dividends, and it will bless so many people. For you to grow in humility, everybody around you wins. Let's pray about it. Lord, I ask you in the name of Jesus to come help us be humble people. Would you lower our pride? Would you forgive us for our arrogance and how our self-centeredness has hurt others? Help us to find tangible strategies, disciplines that will help us grow in humility. And God, now, together with my soul friends, my brothers and sisters here at Harpeth, we pray for our elders. Lord Jesus, would you bless, encourage, empower, protect, and personally attend to each elder of this church? Give them joy. Give them strength and wisdom. Would you enrich their marriages and touch their family systems, their children and grandchildren? Would you bless their health? Would you give them a sense of your nearness? And would you grant them continued unity, protect them from division and distraction? Make them one. And would you help us to be members of the body of Christ who serve and love and pray and disciple with surrendered, joyful spirits? Lord, fill this church with your Spirit. Jesus, this is your church. You alone get to determine who we are, where we're going. We lift you up as the head of the body. Help us to receive your authority as a gift of grace, not a threat. Jesus, we offer ourselves to you now. Every part of our lives, our sin, our shame, our fears, our stress, our pride, we give it all to you. We pray in your name. Amen.